talking about operant conditioning today and how it differs in some ways from classical conditioning and also how it overlaps in some ways with classical conditioning. So we talked early in the course about Thorndike's law of effect, which sounded like common sense, but so does the sun going around the earth until you amass enough data to challenge that common sense. So this turns out to be right, but it wasn't really well understood until a man named B.F. Skinner comes along. The law of effect says essentially associations, remember, learning is associating. Ring the bell, gets associated with food, produces salivation, right? That's classical conditioning. Associations between a response and a stimulus followed by pleasant consequences tend to get strengthened. Those which are followed by neutral or unpleasant consequences tend to get weakened. But now we're talking about operant conditioning, right? And that's behavior that you emit voluntarily, right? You can get really strong, long-lasting effects from one trial learning for sickness, pain, right, and fear. But that's what we're talking about, the cascade of adrenaline that comes from that, or the quivering of the nausea that comes from that, right? Or the saliva that's produced by the bell ringing, right? Those are physiological things, and that's classical conditioning. Under operant conditioning, we're talking about now the responses themselves, the behavioral ones that we can emit and choose, but don't seem to be choosing in some cases, are controlled by consequences. So those responses being controlled by consequences were best explored by B.F. Skinner. Now, there were a lot of other very important researchers other than Watson, other than Skinner, other than Pavlov that we won't go into, but if you get into higher levels of learning in psychology, you'll learn about Clark Hall and many others, Tolman, etc. B.F. Skinner got a little asterisk beside his name because he's a very important figure. We already talked about him in the early part of the course when we were talking about behaviorism. Well, we're knee-deep in behaviorism right now. That's the predominant school of thought we're looking at. And he demonstrated this. He demonstrated it scientifically, methodically, and convincingly, such that we really don't question a lot of his findings because they turned out to be very much replicable and applicable. Very practical, this information. If you understand this information thoroughly, you can change your life with it. You can change other people's lives with it. You can do it for better or for worse, so I hope you will be benevolent with your powers once you've acquired them. But you have to understand it well. Not rocket science, but it is science, and these terms matter, and the contingencies, the if-then statements, are what we're talking about here. The circumstances that produce a response, that response then brings a consequence. The consequence then feeds back to make the organism more or less likely to do a similar response in similar future circumstances. So operant chamber is this old Skinner box over here. Now, he didn't like it being called the Skinner box. He worked with pigeons and he worked with rats. He did other stuff. He worked with people too, and he designed some really interesting things that didn't get their due probably in terms of credit. But what do you got inside of a Skinner box? Well, you've got a grid through which feces can pass, or urine, but also could be electrified if you're interested in punishment. You've got levers that you can get responses to measure them. You've got devices to record exactly how many responses, what the frequency, intensity, and duration of responses are. You've got different stimuli like lights or buzzers. You've got a food dispenser as a possible mechanism for reinforcement, which we'll talk about. And so you can study in a laboratory with great precision all kinds of facets of behavior that you couldn't do with human beings because it wouldn't be ethical, right? And you learn a lot from that, and people are like, I'm no rat. I'm not a rat. Well, no, you're far, far more complicated than a rat, but you will do things in very similar fashion to a lot of other animals. And if you understand the similarities, of course we can appreciate the differences, but the similarities give us a basis for understanding behavior in a way that makes it predictable. And that's one of the goals of science, right? Measurement and prediction. So you look at the Skinner chamber over here, it doesn't look so good. He puts his baby, little Debbie, in an air crib and published the air crib. And people thought he was a monster putting that baby up in that little air crib. Hey, what's an air crib? Air crib's a little enclosure. The humidity's controlled. Temperature's controlled. You know that back in those days, they had cloth diapers. I don't know if you've seen babies with cloth diapers, but that's a damn mess is what that is, right? It's going to go everywhere, right? It leaks everywhere. And so that means the bedding has to be changed. You've been in the doctor's office where they have the sheets on the table and they could just change the sheet. Well, his crib, you could just change and bring in new clean sheets very quickly. And it had this crazy idea in it. There was a little intercom system so that if the baby was crying or was cooing or needing something, you could hear it from another room and respond to the baby. Now we assume everybody needs that and we call it a baby monitor. And we all put kids in cribs anyway, right? His crib was badass. And people thought he was a lunatic because they thought he's experimenting on his child like a rat. He loved his child. They said, that kid wound up committing suicide, didn't she? Myth, no. She's a very successful artist. Nothing bad we can tell. She said her dad was a very loving dad. So what are the consequences that make us do different things? Well, they are reinforcement or punishment. Reinforcers are events that occur after a response that make the response more likely to happen again. Punishers occur after a response and they make that same response less likely to happen again. There are two main categories of reinforcer. One is primary reinforcer. Primary reinforcer is inherently gratifying. You've seen the sign, will work for food. Maybe they're being serious about that, maybe they're not, but if you haven't eaten, by God, you will work for food. You will work for all of those things if you have to get them. Food, you've got to have it. Air, you've got to have it. And people just assume air, but if you're on oxygen tanks, I seen a guy once, the oxygen ran out, and he has a suffering condition. He almost became animalistic as he went almost through me to get to the next oxygen tank. And as soon as he got it, he's like, I'm sorry about that. Changed his behavior dramatically because you got to have it. Most of us just assume we have it. But if you don't, you'll work for it. Shelter, well, you don't have to have the craziest, biggest house on the block, right? But shelter helps. Helps you out with the elements. Helps you from keeping bad people out and keeping the good people in. Sometimes, unfortunately, keeps the bad people in and the good people out. But you don't have to have food like this, do you? Now, if you're in trench warfare in World War I and you didn't get your rations, rats will do. You'll eat rats. You'll eat whatever you have to eat to survive, because you remember, we got a survival instinct. We try to live. People who suicide have gone past that instinct and overridden it somehow, which is not easy to do, and we don't want anybody to do it, so we want to keep them around and show them other alternatives. Clothing doesn't matter in the tropics. Right? If you're on the equator, you don't need a big old fuzzy coat. But if you live up in the Arctic region, you've got to have certain clothing to live, and sex. Sex is part of the species. That's really what Freud was talking about, more or less, was sexual energy in terms of what motivates us as species to make more of us, to create a society and regenerate ourselves. But think about that. Think about sex, and you don't need other people to have sex, right? You can do it by yourself. We lost a good Surgeon General, Jocelyn Elders, because she had the audacity to recommend that masturbation might be a good form of safe sex. Well, it is. It's about as safe as it gets. And why not have that as a possibility if it fits in your worldview? But some people said, no, you shouldn't tell people that. But here's the thing. Think about all the politicians who got into trouble. They had everything, right? Everything they could possibly want. And then they get involved in what? A sex scandal, right, exactly. Tell me that's not a powerful variable. And it's, why is it primary? Because it's built into the species. It's inherently gratifying. The orgasm is something that you experience as an organism. You don't have to learn it. No associations. You don't need it all the time. We're not like lower animals. We have choices we can make. We don't go into mating season and go nuts with it, right? We have societies that have prescriptions and prohibitions, and when people don't follow them, you would look kind of like, why couldn't you? Because that was a very powerful motivator. Part of biology. Just part of being a reproducing species. Nothing that has to be weird about it other than recognizing it's powerful. People will do things for those primary reinforcers, but you don't usually work for food, right? You don't usually work for shelter. You work for something else that you then convert into food and shelter, right? Secondary reinforcers are things that are not originally inherently gratifying, but they acquire a power that is almost as powerful, and in some cases maybe more powerful than primary reinforcers because of their association with primary reinforcement. You don't give a one-year-old a $100 bill, do you? Doesn't mean anything to it. What means something to a kid? Being cuddled, that touch factor, right? Being warm, being fed, being sheltered, secure. But you give them a $100 bill, it doesn't have any inherent gratifying meaning. They stick it in their mouth, they tear it up, doesn't mean anything. But you give them time where now they're toddlers and they go into stores and they see something they want, they go, I want that. And you say, no, that costs too much money. Or we have some at home, I'm not going to spend the money. And they see you exchanging what? Tokens for things. Now a kid gets to be a little bit older and they understand the power of money, right? You get enough of it. Well, it doesn't have to be money per se. There's other kinds of things that you can now associate, right? You don't need a car like that to get around, do you? But is anybody going to really turn one down if they're offered it, right? Because it has what? Image, fashion, style, power projection, or if you're really practical, you can sell it and buy a couple other cheaper cars and then still have money for dinner, right? So it's got this associated reinforcement value, and reinforcers are something we work for. So we don't work directly necessarily for some primary reinforcers, but the secondary reinforcers can get us the primary reinforcers, and they themselves can acquire power of their own such that people work for just them. Some people have more money than they could literally ever spend. But they keep working to obtain more because it's gratifying now. It's got a gratifying property that it didn't have when you were 1 year old, right? So that is the concept behind secondary reinforcement.